Oh, welcome to this course on theories and modalities impacting today's preacher. Just want to read the purpose statement right out of the catalog about this course. And in teaching this course to preachers and preachers who have been preaching for quite a while as the doctoral level, we're going to be looking at preaching and trying to look at it afresh, even though we've been doing this for many years. But this the purpose statement of this course is to develop doctoral students' ability to summarize, formulate, and evaluate theological and theoretical principles related to preaching to a multimedia generation, and to enhance the students' ability to assess the values and impact of preparing and delivering effective biblical messages using a variety of homiletical techniques and designs. Well, that's a pretty lofty purpose there, but as you'll see as we address these different topics in this course, we're going to talk about how preaching today is different than in previous generations, that our audience is different, our congregations are different, that where before the preacher was considered the real expert in the community, the one that everybody looked to for the pastor's opinion, now we're finding that we're competing with a host of different opinions and opinion makers. Well, in this first session, I want to address this matter of discovery, the adventure of discovery. And so what I'll be doing today is talking about the different phases of preparing to preach and preaching. We're talking about different aspects of our congregations and our audiences and that type of thing. And so I want to begin with this first session in this course on theories and modalities impacting today's preacher by addressing the topic, the adventure of discovery. There have been three brief periods of time over the last 30 years when I did not preach week after week as the pastor of a local church. And all three times, even though I was involved in ministry, different types of ministry, I was still a most miserable fellow. I was still in ministry, but the ministry took a different form than pastoral preaching, and I longed to be back in the pulpit. The first time was after finishing seminary, and I accepted a position on the staff of a large church. I was the minister of youth and education. And I would get to preach occasionally, you know, the Sunday after Christmas, the 4th of July weekend, those type of Sundays that senior pastors are noted for passing off to an associate. But I'd already been preaching for 5 years. I'd preached while I was in college and in seminary, and I it was difficult for me, even though I was up there in the front. Offering the pastoral prayer or being involved in some other aspect of worship, it was often difficult for me to just sit there and listen to someone else when I was chomping at the bits to preach myself. The second time was when I traveled in a renewal ministry. And so I was preaching most Sundays, but it was to different congregations. And to my surprise, I found I missed feeding the flock, interacting with the people, my people. And for me, the realization that preaching needs to be in the context of pastoral care caused me to go after the first opportunity that came my way to be the pastor again of a local church. And then the third time occurred when my wife and I moved to a city to start a new church. We started with home Bible studies during the weekday nights, and it was a while before we began Sunday morning worship services. I visited other churches on Sunday mornings, and I was a very fidgety pew sitter. It especially distressed me when the guy up front did not deal with the biblical text in the way that it seemed obvious to me. You know, here he's reading a text, and sometimes I'd see them just put the Bible aside and not even deal with the text, and it was just a frustrating time for me. Well, what I discovered during those out-of-the-pulpit times was it was not so much the actual preaching of the sermon that I most missed as it was the preparing to preach through interaction with the scriptural text and sensing God's word for the people of God. Of all things, I missed doing my homework. Now, certainly I continued to read my Bible and to pray, but for me, anyway, it was different. It was somewhat like looking in my mother's refrigerator after my father died and seeing TV dinners and frozen pizzas and things that were never in Mama's refrigerator before. And I asked Mama why was she eating these frozen meals, and she said that it just wasn't the same cooking for herself as it was cooking for other people. Well, you see, it's one thing to do a personal Bible study to feed yourself, but it's something else entirely to feed the flock of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so in this first session of this course, I want to encourage you toward discovering, or rediscovering the joy of preparing to preach. Let's give some language to this process. Discovery, design, deepening, and delivery. While delivering the message may seem to be all the people here, the first phases make it possible for us to preach in such a way as to accurately handle the word of truth and to authentically engage the people before us. I'm grateful to Kenton Anderson for what he calls integrative preaching, and he calls these four stages of sermon preparation discovery, construction, assimilation, and delivery. Well, since he already had two words starting with D's, I did the old good old preacher alliteration thing and changed construction to design and assimilation to deepening. So discovery, design, deepening, delivery. You can read more about Anderson's integrative model for preaching in the book Preaching with Conviction, Connecting with Postmodern Listeners. Well, in the discovery phase, we're after, as Anderson says, what is God saying through this text to these people at this time? Discovery teams use tools. If you've read about the Lewis and Clark expedition and the Corps of Discovery, you know that they packed along a lot of tools in order to provide President Thomas Jefferson with the information he wanted to know about the Missouri River Valley. And as preachers, we need tools like Bible translations and concordances and word studies, commentaries, theological treatises, in order to mine the truths in a scriptural text. But the key question is, what is God saying through this text? And as interesting as it may be to find out what other people have interpreted this text to say, we want to know what God is saying today through this text to us. Speak, Lord, for your servant heareth. The discovery phase of preparing to preach implies doing what Psalm 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. Well, let's learn how to be still before a text of Scripture and let God reveal to us what he wants us to know about him through this text. And again, I know that I'm preaching to the choir here, talking to people who have been doing this for a number of years. But if anything, through this course, I want to hope to instill a new love, a new passion for doing our homework, a new passion for being still, for knowing God, and for discovering in the text what God is saying to us and to our people. We see sometimes a text discovers us when we were not necessarily looking for it. Early in the week, it's my practice to read the passage of Scripture, get familiar with it, but to not get ahead of myself with assuming the direction the sermon is going to take. I like to soak in the text first, to marinate in the text. And not long ago, I had read a portion of John chapter 1 that I was planning to preach on. I didn't know exactly how I was going to preach on it, but I was reading the text. I'd read it a number of times. Had the intention of preaching on some aspect of the passage. When something happened one night after my initial readings of the text that got my attention and caused me to go in a different direction with the text. Well, what happened was that the lights went out. The lights went out in our house, and as you can imagine, it was really dark. It was a freak accident. Someone driving missed a curve, hit a power pole, and plunged our section of town into darkness. Well, I noticed the difference that one little light can make when we finally found a candle to light and the matches to light the candle with. And it was that discovery of darkness that gave new insights into seeing Jesus as the light that shines in the darkness, John 1:5. I still did my homework when the lights came back on with commentaries and word studies. But the impression of going out in the front yard and seeing a six-block section of town in darkness and the rest of the city with lights impacted me and the way that I looked at the passage of Scripture. Because preaching is about bridging the gap between people and God, Anderson rightly adds the phrase, to these people at this time. What is God saying through this text to these people at this time? One of the surprising discoveries for me as a teacher of preaching is to read sermons and see very little awareness of the people before us. You see, sermons have to connect with people. We have to connect and connect and reconnect and reconnect. We must provide the connecting links so that people can understand how the text of Scripture speaks and applies to them now in their lives, in their situations, to their families, to their work situations, whatever is going on in their lives. And this discovery phase of sermon preparation includes exegeting our congregations, knowing knowing them so well as to be able to intuitively sense where they might need additional information, illustration, or insight. Anderson looks at discovery in terms of moves. What's the story? What's the point? What's the problem? What's the difference? And like a priest going before God with a sacrifice, we come before God on behalf of our people in a sacrificial, for them, approach to preaching. What Anderson calls construction, I refer to preferred the word design, is the second stage of preparing to preach. Here in the light of our homework, due to the discoveries we've made, we begin to think about how to pull things together in such a way as to be able to effectively communicate. Anderson calls the sermon a framework capable of communicating the message. Because we are seeking to communicate with people, or as Dr. Elliott calls them, we're the products of a multimedia generation, the sermonic forms of past generations will not always work effectively today. The 3 points in a poem approach, where each of the points was equal in length and was frankly very predictable. As one layperson described his pastor's sermons, well, they outline very well. I can look at my notes afterward and see what he said. It's just that I don't often feel the Holy Spirit in his preaching. And what an indictment. Anderson looks at sermon construction in terms of answering, so what, what's what, yeah, but, now what? Those were not the kinds of questions people of a previous generation asked. It was enough in a biblically oriented culture to hear the Bible says from the pulpit, and for that to be enough. Today, however, we have to step back and explain, or as Anderson says, tell the story, make the point, engage the problem, imagine the difference. After discovering how dark it was when the lights go out, and becoming aware of insights on John 1:5, in order for me to preach, I had to think about how to design a sermon, this sermon in such a way as to help the people in front of me discover the reality of Jesus as the light of the world. Because I had decided to devote the year to preaching from the Gospel of John, the method I chose for this particular message for preaching was the light in the Gospel of John approach, where other passages were included and became the points of the sermon. See the light, John 1, 4, and 5. Love the light, John 3, 19 to 21. Follow the light, John 8, 12. Trust the light, John 12, 36. And illustrations like being in New Orleans on Hurricane Katrina relief and driving into the darkness on Canal Street in an area of town still without power provided connections with the people and the scripture references. There was in part of town where they brought the lights back on in the French Quarter area, but then driving on Canal Street and suddenly just being plunged into darkness, just darkness all around. It was a really eerie feeling. And I was in a van load of people. And as we got into the darkness, it's like everybody just got quiet and people were whispering, whereas before they were talking and joking and laughing. But the darkness penetrated, the darkness affected us. Well, I had notes for preaching, but was I ready to preach? No. Between stage 1, discovery, stage 2, design, and stage 4, delivery, there must be stage 3, deepening, or what Anderson calls assimilation, receiving the unction to preach, being filled with a message from God by the power of God. Unction. Deepening occurs as we take our sermon manuscript or notes before God on our knees and pray that the Holy Spirit will take what we've prepared and make it into a real sermon, that the coal will come from the altar and touch our poor, stammering tongues. Several years ago, I wrote an article for Kenton Anderson's preaching website on this matter of assimilation. My article concerned the lack of instruction given on this matter of unction. In the article, I told about surveying the homiletics courses of many seminaries and finding very few courses dealing with this matter of deepening. On a practical level, there's very little time for deepening to occur if we've gotten into the habit of Saturday night specials, waiting until the end of the week to pull our sermons together. Yes, we want a fresh word for the people, but that's no justification for procrastination. Experiment with concluding your sermon preparation a day earlier, by Friday instead of Saturday, and notice the difference in confidence and familiarity with the message that an extra day can bring. Later in this course, we'll discuss preaching with a minimum of notes. And the more familiar you are with the flow of the sermon, the easier you'll find it is to preach without a manuscript. I didn't realize it at the time, but I was engaged in a form of assimilation when I drove the 40 miles to my first preaching assignment when I was a junior in college. I'd preach the message in the car on the way there and be all charged up when I arrived at the church building. Later on I had to find other ways of assimilating when my first full-time pastoral opportunity had a parsonage only a half mile from the church. And still other ways of getting ready to preach after getting married and when our children were born, and finding my Sunday morning routine affected by having other people around. But finding ways to assimilate, finding ways to for deepening to occur. Additional discoveries come during the deepening time. With the light of the world references in John 1, I was surprised to see ministry emphasis that I had not noticed before, and areas of application my study had not revealed. In offering my best unto the Lord, what I thought of to be a ready sermon, a completed sermon, the Lord gave increase that I had not expected in terms of giving me additional insights about application and ways to connect with the people. Finally, the moment arrives for the delivery of the sermon. Anderson's stage 4. And I appreciate what he says about the unique, the nothing else like it nature of preaching. He says, the sermon event is a unique moment in time when people hear from God. Virtually unpublishable, the sermon is much more than just the words that are uttered. It is a dynamic event in which people are able to hear from God by means of the preacher. And this little phrase that he used there about virtually unpublishable. If any of you have had someone try to take a tape of yours and then to put that into manuscript form, you're amazed perhaps to see later on, what kind of sentence construction was that? Well, that's because sermons are an oral form. That while we may prepare a manuscript, while we may have an outline, it's communication. It's talking to people. And so because of that, this virtually unpublishable nature sometimes of our sermons, I had the occasion one time to be offered to a writing position for a ministry. And the idea behind this writing position was to listen to the sermons of a famous preacher and then to put to in some way condense in such a way as to make it into a devotional form. And I just couldn't do it because this particular pastor's sentence structure was such that it's like it was just a lot of run-on sentences, and like I couldn't get a handle on it. I said, thank you, but no thanks. Well, this unique moment in time in which we're preaching. Well, Paul seemed to be constantly amazed about preaching and being a preacher. He said in 1 Corinthians 4:1, servants of God and stewards of the mysteries of God, he put it. And then that incredible reference in Romans 10:14, how are they to hear without a preacher? I had an enjoyable conversation with a man who is a director of a well-known school for preachers. He said that many of their students are pastors whose congregations send them to the preaching workshops so they'll come back preaching like the founder of the school. Well, sorry, but that's it's not about being the clone of a famous preacher. It's about getting closer to the Lord Jesus Christ. And out of that relationship, there'll be an overflow that results in effective communication. The day that I preached from the Gospel of John on Jesus being the light of the world, something happened. More than handshakes afterward, you know, good sermon, preacher. There was a sense of God's presence as some of the people were brought before God's word and his light shone in the darkness. You know what? I just can't wait to do it again. To just start the process all over again. The process of discovery, that to hear this passage of Scripture that I thought I knew so much about, to find new insights. This matter of design. What's the best way to share this information with people? What package does it put this together in such a way to impact people in the most positive way? This matter of deepening, of just really soaking and letting this text get inside of me, let God's word affect me all over again. And then the opportunity, get looking forward to it next Sunday, to share the goods, to deliver to the people. This is the word of God for the people of God. Well, this is the type of thing we're going to be talking about in this course. These matters of how as we're impacted by by the word of God, that we get the opportunity to then see God's word impact other people's lives. Well, in our next session, we're going to be talking some more about this this matter of soaking and kind of marinating in a text. And so we'll come back in just a few moments and look at that second topic, okay? In this second session, I want to offer what I hope you'll see as a scriptural model for sermon preparation. This matter here's the days between Sunday and Sunday, and how do we prepare to preach? And so I want to offer a way of that I've found to be helpful in my own life. Sometimes when people ask, well, how do you prepare to preach? As we try to describe it to people, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to them. And so I've tried to analyze, try to pull back and think about that. And so that's what I want to offer to you today. Do you know what it's like to settle for a sermon instead of having soaked in God's presence? And then for preaching to be just an overflow of a fresh touch from the Lord. To settle for a sermon may fill the time on Sunday morning. The text may be properly exegeted. The points may be aligned in awesome alliteration. The sections may be evenly arranged, with point A having the same number of paragraphs as point B and point C. The illustrations may be interesting, nice homiletical material gathered from lots of different sources, and even some wonderful comments from the people as they leave. But you know the empty feeling afterward. You performed well, but you didn't preach. Preaching, real preaching, comes from the overflow of a vital, vibrant relationship with the Lord. Does the Bible provide a model for soaking in God's word that can be adapted to preparing to preach? Well, yes, and I want to share that with you today. When I've been asked how I prepare to preach, I've often given a kind of vague, I just soak in the text for the week and then share what comes my way kind of description, kind of like a tea bag steeping in hot water. But that description didn't seem to help the person who asked the question. They kind of responded, okay. Kind of like if you ask your teenage son to explain how he did what he did on the computer, something that you didn't know you could be done, and you ask and he shows you, but you didn't really understand. Or maybe it's kind of like asking your grandmother for her recipe for tea cakes, but just something she does without thinking about the process. recipe, what recipe? Well, then I remembered the text of Scripture, Deuteronomy chapter 6. More accurately, the "when you rise up" phrase from Deuteronomy, because that was what often happened to me. I'll wake up thinking of something I hadn't thought about and how it relates to the passage I've been soaking in. I keep a pad of paper by the bed because I want to be able to jot down fresh insights. Well, follow the progression of Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 8, and see how it applies to preaching, especially how it applies to taking a passage of Scripture and walking around with it for a week. So from the passage from Deuteronomy chapter 6, 4 through 8, a familiar passage of Scripture that I want us to look at together here. New Bible, so the page is kind of, there we go. So here's this passage. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Well, this word "hear," as you probably are familiar, Shema, S-H-E-M-A is how it's often spelled, taking the Hebrew into English. Shema, hear. I want to hear from God that what he has for me, and what he wants to communicate through me to other people. I want to approach the text with my ears open, listening, praying, paying attention, really hearing. Now, as I'm talking, I'm just assuming that, making the assumption, I probably shouldn't, but just making the assumption that you're dealing with one primary text of Scripture. Now, I know that there are a number of people that kind of do a chain of pearls kind of type of preaching, where this one verse to another, kind of a topical approach. But I want to really just focus on taking a text of Scripture. It can be paragraph length long, it can be a chapter length long, it can be a verse long, but just dealing with that text, just really trying to mine the goods out of that text. And so that's the approach that I'm talking about in soaking in a text of Scripture. Not soaking in a lot of different texts of Scripture, but soaking in one text. Now certainly that one text may cause us to think about other passages of Scripture, may even bring those other passages of Scripture in. But I want to just advocate, just taking a text, this selection, a pericope is the homiletical word for it, that text of Scripture, and just soaking in it. Well, hear, O Israel. And so I want to hear what the Lord has to say. Excuse me. Say to me, saying to me through this passage of Scripture. Then you notice the word, hear, O Israel, is in this verse. Here in Deuteronomy 6, the Israel is the nation of Israel. But the nation got its name from a man whom God gave the name Israel. The name means he who strives with God, he who struggles with God, or wrestler with God. From the Genesis 32 story of Jacob wrestling and saying, I will not let you go until you bless me. Well, what about it, O Israel? Knowing this one we're wrestling with can cause us to walk with a limp. Let's bring the same determination to our time in the text, with submission, with humility, and yet wrestling for the blessing. I will not let you go until you bless me. And sometimes we cut that off too quickly. We rush off to find out what somebody else has to say in terms of a commentary or in terms of downloading someone else's sermon. But this matter of wrestling with the text, I want to just encourage you to spend time, spend time in God's Word. I would even advocate doing this several days in the week before you rush off to consult with someone else, other commentaries. Here you notice this next phrase, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Well, what areas of my life need to come under the great I am? Is Jesus first? The one for me in my life. And how does this text help bring me under the lordship of Jesus Christ? And you shall love the Lord your God. You notice the next phrase of this passage of Scripture. Just thinking about love, how love is emphasized in this verse here. That what lover would take a love letter, and then take it apart by diagramming the sentences, parsing the verbs, doubting the authorship. Well, let's recapture the romance of spending time with the one who loves us by reading his words with rapt attention and our hearts beating rapidly. Now, yes, we'll discuss hermeneutics and tools for getting the most out of a passage, but let's begin as lovers of God and lovers of his word. Psalm 119 follows the Hebrew alphabet, as you know, to find 176 ways to express gratitude to God for his word. Listen to these verses about loving God's word. And I recall the first time that I read through Psalm 119, or the first time that I read through it as a believer, as a kid, I had, was told, read your Bible, say your prayers, and I would kind of flip open whatever. But I recall it was between classes one time when I was a sophomore at a Christian college, and I was reading my Bible, and I just started reading in Psalm 119, and it's like the lights went on for me. It's like, wow, all this is about God's Word and loving God's Word. Well, of course, other people had known that. People had written whole books about it. But it was a discovery for me. And I think we need to rediscover that love for God's Word that the psalmist had. To think about, A through Z ways of describing love for God's Word. Just incredible. Well, notice a verse like verse 49 of Psalm 119. I find my delight in thy commandments, which I love. I revere thy commandments, which I love, and will meditate on thy statutes. Verse 50. Oh, how I love thy law is my meditation all the day. Verse 97. I love thy commandments above gold, above fine gold. Verse 127. My soul keeps thy testimonies, and I love them exceedingly. And so when you read in the Psalms about how here's this incredible love for God's Word, and remembering that the psalmist at the time was only basing that on what we call the first five books of the Bible, on the Pentateuch. Now we now we have all of God's Word, the Old Testament and New Testament. We have all the Psalms, we have the Gospels, and to just love God's Word. Well, love the Lord your God. You know, love His Word. In the area of the arts, music, painting, literature, there are art critics and music critics and poetry critics who have been carefully trained in appreciating craftsmanship. Take, for example, a movie critic. This is someone who really loves movies. You know, going to several movies a week and giving the thumbs up or the thumbs down, excuse me, based on plot, characters, cinematography, costumes, dialogue. They love movies so much they want to help movie ticket buyers know which movies to go see. They take their love for the movies and get paid to watch movies. You know, what a gig. Well, sometimes it's hard to tell if Bible critics love the Bible. There's nothing inherently wrong with doing historical criticism or rhetorical criticism or form criticism, just like there's nothing wrong with a movie critic talking about the acting or the writing or the directing. But if the movie critic is someone who clearly does not like the movies, then their opinions would be suspect. Not just a particular movie, but movies in general. Well, let's take our love for God and ask Him to increase our appetite and appreciation for His Word. Now, Jeremiah clearly loved God's Word. As he said in chapter 15, verse 16, "Thy words were found, and I ate them. And thy words became to me a joy and a delight of my heart. For I am called by thy name, O Lord, God of hosts." Now, I'm addressing this matter of love for God's Word in the context of biblical criticism because I've seen too many people start theological studies with a great love for God and His Word only to lose their passion for God's Word because they did not hold on to their first love relationship with the Lord and became overly influenced by being exposed to critics who clearly have their own agendas to debunk, demythologize, denounce, deny the deity who inspired the writing of the Bible. And in offering this course to doctoral level students, it may be that it's time for just a fresh touch and for you to renew that first love. That perhaps some of you are approaching getting another degree as a way looking at a promotion, looking at lining yourself up for a better job or whatever. But what I hope happens through this process is that just a new enthusiasm, a new love for God's Word occurs as you're interacting with Scripture and thinking about these assignments related to this course. Again, to describe with a movie critic perspective, have you ever watched a movie that you thoroughly enjoyed only to later have someone talk badly about the movie? You know, you said thumbs up and they said thumbs down. Well, was it a good movie? Well, yes, because something in you connected with the movie. You felt something. You thought something. You liked it. You enjoyed spending the time watching that particular movie. Well, is the other person wrong? Not necessarily. If that person's a movie critic, he or she is looking for certain things and basing the evaluation on the scores in the different categories, somewhat like a Trinity evaluation form. And if the scores in the different categories are low, then the movie gets a bad review. Well, as preachers, we have to be bold enough to say, this is God's Word, and I love God's Word because I've experienced the presence of God in the pages of this book. Some of you may have lost some friends over this. I went to college and seminary with several guys who were just on fire for the Lord when they started out. Several were older than the average college student and had to quit careers and uproot their families and move to attend school. Aren't you glad you don't have to do that to take Trinity courses? Well, these people were genuinely called to pastoral ministry and loved the Lord, but somewhere in the writing of term papers or being enamored by liberal professors or getting away from the relationship of real-life Christians or wanting to be accepted in denominational settings, not wanting to be labeled as conservative, they lost what they had. Hollow men, T.S. Eliot called people like this. A shell on the outside, but hollow within. Most of them are still involved in ministry. Some even have large churches and denominational positions. But the light has gone out of their eyes. There's no joy there. They're going through the motions, and their dead churches don't know the difference. Well, recapture that love. Love for the Lord. Love for His Word. Contrast this statement with this statement again from Psalm 119, "Thy promise is well tried, and thy servant loves it." And so to contrast that and thinking about the opportunity to share with people that, you know, here are promises that we've discovered, that we've found to be true, that, is well tried. And we love it, and we want to see other people experience this as well. Back again to Deuteronomy 6, 4 to 8, where we're told how to love the Lord, and that's with all our hearts, souls, and strength. Well, loving the Lord with our hearts, the Hebrew word here, leib, L-E-B, is defined by Nelson's Bible Dictionary as the inner self that thinks, feels, and decides, that which is central to a person. And Unger's Dictionary calls the heart the innermost center of the natural condition of humanity, the center of bodily life, the center of the rational, spiritual nature, the center of the moral life. In the Bible, all the emotions are described as being experienced by the heart. Love, pain, joy, sorrow, peace, bitterness, courage, fear. And in the Bible, the thinking process is also connected to the heart. The intellectual activity, we would say, occurs in the mind. The Bible says originates in the heart. The heart is said to think in Esther 6:6, to understand in Job 38:36, to imagine in Jeremiah 9:14, to remember in Deuteronomy 4:9, to have wisdom in Proverbs 2:10, to think to itself, Deuteronomy 7:17. To love the Lord with all our hearts, when it comes to soaking in a scripture text, means we bring all our emotions and our thoughts and the totality of our personalities to the time with God and His Word. We're also seeking the Father's heart in the passage of Scripture. What does this text tell me about the Father's heart and what motivates Him? What am I sensing about His heart for me and for them? And what about loving the Lord with all our souls? You have a slide here with all these heart references. But again, this question, what does this tell me about the Father's heart as we look at these different references from Esther and Job and Jeremiah and Deuteronomy, Proverbs, and again from Deuteronomy? But then this matter of what's it mean to love the Lord with all our souls? And man became a living soul, Genesis 2:7 says. A living nephesh, Hebrew, N-E-P-H-E-S-H. Here's the essence of life, is the act of breathing. Again, the Bible dictionaries help us, as Nelson's Bible Dictionary sees, two distinct meanings. That which makes a human alive, and the inner life of the person, the seat of the person's emotions, the seat of human personality. Like in Psalm 63:1, my soul thirsteth for thee, my flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is. The psalmist's entire personality aches for God. Unger describes the soul as that all that pertains to the person, the seat of the feelings, desires, affections, and aversions. The soul has to do with life. Well, what's life-giving in this passage of Scripture? Here you've selected a passage of Scripture, and you've been reading it, and you're thinking about it. You're just seeking to learn as much as you can about this passage. What's life-giving in the passage? What breathes new life into me through this text? Is there an obstruction blocking the airflow? Have I been settling for shallow breathing when God wants me to breathe deeply in His Word? I've had the privilege to go to Mackinac Island in Michigan a couple of times on vacation. I've got a friend that just really enjoys going there, and so it was made arrangements for my wife and I to go up to Mackinac Island. And reading some about the history of Mackinac Island, that people began going there because they found that the air was so pure that it was like a place for people who had respiratory problems to go and just breathe the fresh air. And I felt that as well. Just so much energy I had while I was there because the air is pure. Well, as we get into the pure Word of God, we find that we're just, there's a new energy level there, life-giving in an energy level. To love the Lord with our souls when we're engaged in soaking in God's Word means to be energized by the pure inspiration of the Word of God. How does this passage point to life? New life, abundant life, resurrection life, the life, Jesus, and loving the Lord with all our might. Let's think about that. And here the Hebrew word meod, M-E-O-D. O-D, Mahod is, as you pronounced, M-E-H-O-D-E, means strength. And the American Heritage Dictionary calls strength a source of power or force, as in the strength to go on, inner fortitude. For a number of years, I had heard about Leonard Ravenhill. I'd read his some of his books, and I heard about this great evangelist. And he was in his 80s, still preaching when I got to finally get to hear him preach. He was thin, almost frail in body, but strong in the Lord. Well, where does that kind of energy come from? It's from the strength of the Lord. You know, John Wesley preached several times a day, even into his late 80s. And as I heard Leonard Ravenhill that day, I thought, that's what it must be like to hear John Wesley. Well, great love for the Lord leads to great might in our lives. The familiar words of Isaiah apply. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard? That the everlasting God, the Lord, is the creator of the ends of the earth. That he fainteth not, neither is weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He gives power to the saint and to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Isaiah 40, verses 28 to 31. Well, to love the Lord with all our strength while being immersed in a passage of Scripture implies giving our best strength to that time when God's Word is before us. Well, are you a morning person? Then give God your mornings. If you're more alert later in the day, give that time to God. When are you least likely to be interrupted? Do you get along with God better on a nature trail than your office? Then take your Bible and pad and pencil on a hike. You know, Eugene Peterson said he did that most Mondays when he was a pastor in Maryland. Does your strength come in days apart in a theological library? When you can soak up all you can, then take a month to digest and then go back for more? Or does your strength come when you get with a trusted friend and pray and share? To draw strength from a scripture passage, look at the text in very practical terms. How does this text impact daily living? The strength to go on. You see, our people need that desperately. Where's the encouragement, the hope, the new energy? And while preaching, let's not hold back. Let's love the Lord with all our might while we're preaching, fully engaged, passionate, on fire, knowing we're speaking of nothing less than the eternal destinies of the people who are listening. Continue to apply Deuteronomy 6, 4-8 to preparing to preach on a passage of Scripture. And notice these words, as it says, "And these words which I command you this day shall be in thine heart." And then notice six ways of getting God's Word fixed in our hearts. If we'll let these six ways become a regular part of our relationship with the Lord, we will never be without something to say on Sunday morning or in those in-season, out-of-season times that sometimes come along. First, teach them diligently unto thy children. Now, why wait till Sunday to share some of the insights the Lord is showing us? Let your family in on it so that they'll also see the value of spending time in God's Word. And it's often surprising the insights they may have. They teach us too. So you got a text on forgiveness? Well, what about forgiveness at home? The text is on the strength of the Lord? Well, who in the family is fatigued? The worse than an infidel verse in 1 Timothy 5:8 addresses not providing for one's family. Well, what about spiritual provision through sharing what's hot and fresh from the Lord? Not the whole sermon, but the insights the Lord is revealing to you along the way. Second, talk of them when thou sittest in thine house. Having been raised in a parsonage and now as a pastor, I know that children do not always hear good things around the dinner table. For a couple of years on Sunday at our church, it was Lewis for lunch because of the rather unusual thing that Lewis, the worship leader, did at church that day. Let's talk instead about what the Lord is doing, and we can get through that announcing our text. We can do that through announcing our text to our families early in the week and talking about what comes to their minds in the passage. Third, and when thou walkest by the way. I'm a big believer in not confining study time to the study. With the passage in mind, take a walk with it or take a drive with it, or mow the lawn with it, or go fishing with it. If you've got the Bible on tape, cue it up to the passage and listen to it again and again in your car. Or just turn off the radio and let the Lord give you new insights on the passage. Want to go for a walk, buddy? Is all I have to say to our dog, who's part chow, part Heinz 57. You know, and he's ready for a walk. He's tearing out the door, ready to go. Well, want to go for a walk, David? You know, I think our master is often inviting us to go walk with him. And we think we have to stay in our seats to sermonize. You know, it really is scriptural. You know, take a hike. Fourth, when thou liest down, you probably have a Bible by your bedside. We'll look over the passage again before going to bed. I have a version I do not use for preaching by the bedside because I want another look at the same passage. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. Isaiah 26:3. Well, that sounds better than sleeping pills, doesn't it? Now, fifth, and when thou risest up, this verse in Deuteronomy says, I've already shared about when I went looking for this text from Deuteronomy, when I thought about this phrase, when thou risest up. It's frequent that I wake up with thoughts related to the text I've been soaking in. That happened recently as I had been thinking about this particular passage in the context of sharing in this class. And then decided to also preach on this passage at our church. I don't necessarily recommend this, but I had a general idea of the direction I wanted to share the passage, but it was not totally clear to me. I didn't panic because I've learned that when I soak in a passage for the week, kind of marinating in the text, that the Lord will pull it together. Not always had that assurance and spent many late Saturday nights trying to pull together a Saturday night special, even to the point where we didn't go out much on Saturday evenings. But I've learned to rely on the Lord that He will supply my needs, including my need for a Sunday sermon. What came to me as I rose up that Sunday morning was how different people I'd been around recently who really loved the Lord and yet had experienced great trials and difficulties. They loved the Lord in spite of their adversities. And I felt like the Lord wanted me to start there by telling their stories. Then if they can love the Lord and in those situations, how we can learn more about loving the Lord with all our hearts, souls, and strength. The connection that was needed to bring people into the text was provided as I rose up. This is incredible how in soaking a text, the Lord really does bring illustrations our way. I think it's because our senses are heightened as we're in the text, as we're thinking about the text. And then it's like illustrations on the news, in the newspaper. Other things just come our way. And so it's not a matter of us having to scratch around, but just as we're soaking, the Lord brings these things to us. Sixth. From Deuteronomy 6, 8 to 9, it says to bind them for a sign and write them upon the doorpost. Well, let's apply that to soaking in a text by keeping the text in front of us in a variety of ways. Perhaps by writing the text on index cards and bringing the cards out at a traffic light or some other way of carrying the word around with you. It was the practice of Harry Denman, who was a great Methodist evangelist. He was a layperson, but he led a lot of people to the Lord. And it was his practice just write out long passages of Scripture by handwriting. That he wanted to so get in God's Word into his heart that he would just take the time to write it out. And so after his death, there were just page after page, pages were found of just Scripture, where he had just written down Scripture as ways of getting it into his heart. Well, just different ways of keeping the text before us. We spent the night in a home in St. Louis several years ago when we were attending a conference, and our host showed me his workout room in his basement. Several pieces of fitness equipment, nothing fancy. But what struck me was the very large print Bible verses all around the room, you know, very large font. The guy worked for Xerox and had made a large font copies of Bible verses and had the verses all around the room to see as he lifted weights and as he rode his stationary bike. Well, whatever it takes to soak and keep soaking in a text, let's do it. Well, can you preach without soaking in a text in a Deuteronomy 6, 4-9 manner? Well, sure you can. And you can also eat biscuits from a cardboard can. You know, womp biscuits, like Jerry Clower used to call them. You know, you womp them to get them open. Or you can enjoy the aroma of fresh homemade biscuits. You see, you can do fast food preaching, but wouldn't you rather hear for yourself and wrestle with the text for yourself and bring your preaching fully under the Lordship of Jesus Christ and find your love for the Lord increasing heart, soul, and mind? Wouldn't you like to see sermon preparation is also a time that brings your family closer together and it impacts your whole life and your family's life as well? Well, then hear, O Israel. Well, in our next session, we're going to talk some more about this matter of theories and modalities impacting preaching today. But I really want to encourage you to find ways to immerse yourself, to soak in God's Word, and see the difference that comes out in your preaching. Okay, we'll be back in just a bit for the next session. All right, in this third session, I want to address the topic of a theology for biblical preaching in the 21st century. And so and we've been talking about preaching already, but let's get down to some basics. What is this that we're trying to do? What does it mean to do this today in terms of preaching? And so a definition of preaching that I appreciate is one by J.I. Packer, where he defines preaching as the event of God bringing to an audience a Bible-based, Christ-related, life-impacting message of instruction and direction from himself through the words of a spokesperson. And that's quoted in the Handbook of Contemporary Preaching. Let's unpack this definition. Let's look at it. And again, here at the doctoral level, many of you have been preaching for many years. Myself, I started preaching in puberty. I was very young when I started preaching. Preached my first sermon when I was 19 years old. I was a summer youth director at a church, and they gave me an opportunity one Sunday evening to preach. And I, probably like you, I put everything, you know, put every Bible verse I knew into it, just preached my heart out, and it was like 4 minutes long, you know. But it was the beginning, and I'm so grateful for opportunities that I've had through the years. And I'm also grateful that I've had some of those in season, out of season kind of situations. One that I want to tell you about is I don't recommend this necessarily for you to do to an associate pastor. You might give somebody a heart attack. But I was the summer after my sophomore year of college, I was a youth director at an Indian United Methodist Church, a church for Native Americans in the Tulsa, Oklahoma area. And the pastor of the church was a Choctaw Indian. And one day he called me. He said, put on your coat and tie. I want you to go with me to a funeral. And so I kind of the last moment as I was walking out of the room, I picked up my Bible to take with me. And so we drove out in the country, out from Okmulgee, Oklahoma. And it was a tragic situation. It was a teenage girl had died in a car wreck. And so we started the funeral service, and he didn't tell me until we got into the service. He said, "This is an all-night vigil. We're going to be here a while." And so, sure enough, as the service started, it went on all night. And so there would be times of preaching and singing, and then we'd take a break and have and eat together, and then we'd come back in and more singing and more preaching. And so, at 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, here late at night, he nudged me and said, "It's your turn." I said, "What?" He said, "Your turn to preach." That there had been a number of other pastors there that day who had preached, and so it was now my turn. And so I remember, I'm glad I have a Bible. I didn't have any sermon notes with me, but I don't remember necessarily even what I said. But that occasion of being in season and out of season is something that I always remember. Well, many of us have been preaching for a number of years. And so just to think about this definition of J.I. Packer and just to have a new appreciation of this that we're attempting to do on Sundays. We know we have some Adventist brothers with us as well who do this on Saturdays. But who different people seeking to bring before the people of God a passage of Scripture. And so here's this definition by Packer. Let's take it apart. He says, the event of God. How preaching is a God-initiated activity. The preaching is God's idea. Romans 10:15 says, how can they preach unless they are sent? And so I want to encourage you to have a high view of Scripture, not only of Scripture, but also a high view of preaching that sees the preacher as participating in what God is doing at that moment. That the event is saturated with the Spirit of God in inspiring the preacher's preparation and in enduing the preacher with the ability to communicate effectively. It says in this definition, bringing to an audience. You see, preaching in the New Testament does not demand a congregation of believers. Paul did not refrain from preaching even though he stood before King Agrippa in Acts 26. Preaching must always put the cookies on the bottom shelf so that anyone before us can benefit from what we're saying. We also have to communicate with them without any preconceived ideas about their spirituality or knowledge of spiritual matters. And so for some people who want to sound like they're so spiritual and then they're talking above people's heads, oh, let's put it down where people can understand. Bringing to an audience. Here, Paul gives us the example of preaching, even though there were not Christians before him. Preaching to the people who are out there. This phrase, this definition, Packer has the phrase, a Bible-based message. Now, why be limited to human words about human activities, as stale as yesterday's newspaper, when God's word is eternal and firmly fixed in the heavens, as Psalm 119, verse 89 says? It's God's word that through preaching can be a lamp to their feet and a light to their paths, verse 105 from Psalm 119. It's God's word that can keep them from sinning, in verse 11, Psalm 119. You see, mere human words can't do that. It's God's it's God's word that gives hope, verse 49, gives comfort, verse 52, teaches knowledge and good judgment, verse 66, gives light and understanding. Can mere mortal words do that? No. Give them God's word. And I want to emphasize this because there are some today who are backing away from really taking a text of Scripture and dealing with it and sharing with people. It's like they want to kind of do an end run and not even bring in God's Word. Well, this has to be a Bible-based message. Packer also says that it must be a Christ-related message. 2 Corinthians 4:5, for we preach not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord. Brian Chappell explains what he means by Christ-centered preaching in his book by saying, a passage retains its Christocentric focus and a sermon becomes Christ-centered, not because the preacher finds a slick way of wedging a reference to Jesus' person or work into the message, but because the sermon identifies a function this particular text legitimately serves in the great drama of the Son's crusade against the serpent. That quotation from page 293 of Christ-centered preaching. And so Christ-centered preaching doesn't necessarily that you take a text and try to stick Jesus into it when you're dealing with some Old Testament passage. But here is more about how this text serves the great drama of the Son's crusade against the serpent. That's this scarlet thread of redemption is another way that this has been expressed. Packer continues by saying that this is a life-impacting message. Is faith coming from what they hear? Romans 10:17. Life-changing faith comes by the preaching of Christ. You see, not only may people be saved from hell, but marriages may be saved, and people may set correct priorities for their lives, and bad habits may be broken, and selfishness may be directed toward loving acts of kindness. You see, we're not mere motivational speakers or inspirational entertainers or Christian comedians. Our words, carried by the wind and fire of the Holy Spirit, can change lives. And what an incredible opportunity to be engaged, to be a part of this activity of God. Packer states this is of instruction. Well, see, some people want to separate teaching and preaching, didache and kerygma, but the words are interchangeable in the New Testament. If you'll do a word study, you'll see this. We teach as we preach. We preach as we teach. Our primary curriculum is the kingdom of God. We want to instruct people in God's rule, God's reign, God's authority. We are to teach people how to seek first His kingdom, Matthew 6:33. How to live as kingdom people, that's what the Beatitudes are about. How to pray for the kingdom to come, the Lord's Prayer, Matthew 6:10. how to be a citizen of God's kingdom. Packer also has this phrase, and direction, of instruction and direction. You see, we get to say, this is the way, walk in it. Isaiah 30, verse 21. We get to point people to Jesus, like Thomas. They don't know where or how or what or why, and we get to refer people to Jesus. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. They, that audience before us, they're harassed and helpless. They're like sheep without a shepherd. They're like David's 400 cavemen in 1 Samuel 22. They're in distress, they're in debt, they're discontented, and we get to offer the counsel of the treasures of the wisdom of God from His Word. Postmoderns, while rejecting objective truth, are desperately in need of direction, primarily because they do not know that there is a beacon of light to direct them on their way. And then Packer has the phrase, from himself. Charles Shelton's classic book, In His Steps, tells about a town that was changed because people started asking the question, what would Jesus do? The question was the challenge of a pastor's sermon, but no one was changed more as much as the pastor himself, who first posed the question. He began asking, what would Jesus say to these people, and found his preaching to have a depth that he had not known before. Ray Anderson, in the book The Shape of Practical Theology, rephrases the question, what is Jesus doing? Recognizing that the risen Christ is in our midst. So what is Jesus saying through us to them? In speaking Jesus' words, we want to be careful to say what he is saying in the way that he speaks, not with a preacher tone, but with passionate tenderness, not with guns blazing, but with grace abounding, not in entertaining trivia, but in incarnating truth. And so here's where we fit in, through the words of a spokesperson. John the Baptist said it this way, he must increase, but I must decrease. John 3:30. You see, it's not our show. It's not about us. Remember, God used Balaam's donkey to speak, and as great as Paul was, Eutychus still fell asleep as Paul preached on and on and on. Yet somehow, God uses these sounds shaped by tongue and teeth and lips to penetrate hard hearts, to unsettle made-up minds, and to soothe distressed souls. Even as preaching can be defined in a variety of ways and brings forth a, now that was real preaching response, when spirit and word come together, poetry can be defined in a variety of ways. The poet William Wordsworth defined poetry as the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. It's that spontaneous overflow that is often lacking in our preaching, as the words of life are spoken from the dustbins of old sermon files, the words of someone else's consecrated study, the words not thought through or prayed over, the words that are a poor signpost to the Word made flesh. And if preaching in itself was not challenge enough, just coming up with the words to accurately say what the Word of God says and making application for today, there's that audience that we have to try to reach. It's not our grandfather's congregations we're preaching to anymore. In a family photo album, there's a picture of my grandparents' church in Lakeland, Florida. It was some special occasion. The picture was from the mid-50s. And the photograph was taken from the chancel area at the congregation. There they are in all their 50s finery. Flowered hats, double-breasted suits, post-World War America, in the middle of a decade of prosperity, sitting in their usual pews. In their innocence, they had no clue about what would come in the next few years. JFK's assassination, Vietnam, Watergate, and they certainly had no idea that the new piece of furniture in their living rooms or in their Florida rooms, the family television set, would expose their children and grandchildren to the pervasive reach of postmodernism. The same-sex marriages? Not on their radar screens. To them, a gay bishop would have been a jovial man of God, an ecclesiastical leader who told good jokes when he came to dedicate the new building. That 1950s congregation did not question matters related to truth. Truth could be known. Truth had a source. Truth could be found. God's word was regarded and received as truth. But that's not our audience. Not only has the fashion changed, but so has the culture in which we live. In a book that Jim Thomas wrote in 2000, a book called entitled Coffee House Theology, where real questions meet honest answers. He makes this statement: the cultural melting pot we now live in is bringing together ideas and values from many sources and offers some wonderful benefits, but it has also prompted a crisis over issues like truth, morality, and shared values. And as soon as anyone begins to offer a definition, another person raises up a list of exceptions, usually accompanied by the statement, "Who are you to push your values on me?" The result is a culture frozen in moral stalemate, impotent to speak with clarity on difficult moral issues like the teaching of ethics in our school systems, how to handle violent criminals, how to go about eliminating racism, and how to handle issues like abortion and euthanasia, end quotation from Jim Thomas in his book, Coffee House Theology. You see, our audience has changed, but the gospel has not changed. We must, however, be wise to where they're coming from. Like Paul in Athens in Acts 17, we are bringing strange ideas to their ears. And like Paul, we must look around us and see what the people are worshiping. Douglas Gruthius, in the book Truth Decay, Defending Christianity Against the Challenges of Postmodernism, explains. Gruthius says, "For these postmodernist thinkers, the very idea of truth has decayed and disintegrated. It is no longer something knowable by anyone who engages in the proper forms of investigation and study. Truth is not over and above us, something that can be conveyed across cultures and over time. It is inseparable from our cultural conditioning, our psychology, our race, and our gender. At the end of the day, truth is simply what we are. We as individuals and as communities make it to be, and nothing more. Truth dissolves into a host of disconnected truths, all equal to each other, but unrelated to one another. There's no overall rational scheme of things." And this is what's happened in the minds of those who do not consider absolute truth. Well, how to preach in an atmosphere where truth is not recognized as truth? Well, that's our challenge. Gruthius comments, "Some church growth advocates advise that churches tone down any emphasis on objective truth or of Christian doctrine because postmoderns have short attention spans and are only interested in their felt needs. Many counsel that Generation Xers can be reached only by a relational and largely non-cognitive approach." Well, what about it? How has your preaching been affected by attempts to adapt to this changing environment? Our audience is much different than previous generations. A snapshot of an American audience today would find 72% of the 18 to 25-year-olds saying there's no such thing as absolute truth. 66% of Americans generally agreeing, and even 53% of those who call themselves Christians, those who call themselves Christians believe that there are no absolutes. This is quoted from Bill Strom's More Than Talk, published in 1998. Well, with more than half of our congregations not believing in absolutes, we find ourselves in the role of evangelists, not just expositors. We have to convince them that truth is real, that truth can be known, that truth is found in the Word of God, and that Jesus Christ is the ultimate truth. So this course is about being effective evangelists. As Douglas Gruthius puts it, bearing witness to the truth of Christ and His gospel means being savvy to postmodern realities culturally. It does not mean capitulating to postmodern unrealities philosophically or theologically. You see, what a privilege. What a human impossibility. What a Savior who entrusts His word to these poor, lisping, stammering tongues. And what a time to be proclaimers of timeless truth. Well, in our next session together, we're going to talk some more about connecting with people in this time, connecting with postmoderns, connecting with multimedia generation, connecting with people whose attention span is so short. So when we come back, we'll address this topic. Okay, thank you.